let us quickly look at 7.2 before we go to open. And in 7.2 we will look at B, because A is only formula substitution. Here it is given that actually 7.2 should be made separately as a problem. You have two identical systems of the same mass m and specific heat capacity Cp, temperatures Ta and Tb, pressure P naught, final state equilibrium with each other, that means some common temperature, pressure is already common. Process no change of phase, adiabatic and constant temperature, constant pressure. So let us say that we have one system A and you have another system B. This is at TA, this is at TB. They work at constant pressure, so this remains at P naught, this remains at P naught. The constant heat capacity, so Cp also is common, Cp also is common. And all that we will do is we will combine them together. Say let them interact and let us extract a work W. What is this W max? How will you calculate? That is one way, more engineering way of doing it. One, you can substitute formula. But if you do change in availability, remember that they are not interacting with the environment at all. Which dead state? They come into equilibrium with each other. So there is no mention of an environment. Environment does not come into picture. They will come to some common temperature, right? By, if we do not do anything, just put them in an isolated environment, all that will happen is A will lose heat to B or B will lose heat to A till they come to a common temperature T naught. And that is our simple energy balance we can do, apply first law and do. We can. But then you will find that there is some entropy produced. Entropy produced means you could have obtained some work but which you have not obtained. Suppose what we could have done is we could have imagined a reversible engine working between the two. Assume for example that TA is higher than TB. Then that reversible engine could take a small amount of heat dQA from A, dQB from, reject dQB to B and do a small amount of work dW. Ratio of dQ and dQB will be related to TA and TB. But because these are finite bodies of mass m each, right, same mass m, moment dQ is extracted, TA will reduce a bit. You can relate it to dQ and m and Cp. dQB is made available to TB. So you can relate delta TB to dQB and m and Cp. So after the first cycle or the first interaction, TA will reduce, TB will increase, not by the same amount because higher energy is extracted, lower heat is provided. So reduction in TA will be higher, increase in TB will be lower. But there will still be some difference and you can continue running the engine till TA becomes equal to TB. But then it will not be TA plus TB by 2, although they are of the same mass and same heat capacity. In fact, the resulting resonating temperature will be nearer TB than to TA, because higher amount of heat is extracted from TA, lower amount of heat is made available to TB. The difference is the work done. And you can write down this equation and integrate it and spend 2 pages of algebra. There is another way of doing it. Apply first law, apply second law. I am not saying apply availability or exergy analysis. Apply first law, apply second law. Let us say that final initial state one system at TA, another system at TB. Final state both systems at say some temperature TC, A as well as B. What would be the process? For A and B together, it should be an adiabatic process. But there will be a W and we want our SP to be equal to 0. That means in the process for the whole system, delta S should be 0. Okay. Now apply first law to the system. Q equals delta E plus W. Okay. What is Q? 0. How do you treat delta E plus W? Both are executing constant pressure processes. So that means after some algebra, you should be able to show that this is delta H plus W non-PDV. Because they are executing constant pressure processes without a change of phase. So there could be some change in volume. So let us neglect that work, saying it is done. So this is W non-PDV and this is what we are going to maximize. Is that right? Because when only PDV work is done, Q is delta H. Okay, so this is our first law. What about second law? It's adiabatic. So second law in principle says that Q by T, whatever, plus SP is delta S. This is going to be 0. We want it reversible. So this also is 0. This is given, this is needed to give us maximum work or maximum W non-PD. Now that gives us the following. Delta S is 0 and W non-PDV will be equal to minus delta H. Now delta S equals 0, expand in terms of the two systems. They are going to work at constant pressure, there is no change of phase. So system A goes from TA to TC, system B goes from TA to TC. So delta S is going to be equal to MA Cp log of TC by TA, that is the delta S of the A part, plus MB Cp log of TC by since this has to be equal to 0 and MA equals MB, CP equals CP, this means that TC TC divided by TA TB will be 1. So that means TC equals square root of TA TB. geometric mean of TATB, not arithmetic mean. If we were to just leave it to themselves, not extract any work, we would have got arithmetic mean. And we know that the geometric mean of two positive numbers is lower than the arithmetic mean. So the mean temperature of the system will now be lower. So whatever is the lower reduction in energy, that will be made available as work. And now you substitute this in delta H and you will get W non-PdV, and that too, this will be the maximum, will turn out to be minus mCp TA minus TC minus mCp for the second part TB minus. Okay. Why can't we apply our standard availability analysis to this? Because there is no heat transfer with the environment, that is enforced to be 0. So that is not a variable that we have. But what is it that we have changed? We have changed the end state. See, if we were to leave the two systems to themselves, they would have reached a temperature TA plus TB by 2. If one were at say 300 Kelvin, another way were to be at 600 Kelvin, they would have reached 450 Kelvin. But now they are not reaching 450 Kelvin. They are reaching square root of 600 plus 600 into 400. How much is that? 600 multiplied by 300, sorry. They reached 424.3 Kelvin. So that difference between 450 and 424.3, that difference in energy, corresponding energy, is what is available to us as work. Energy reduces, so there is a work out. Okay. Any questions on this so far? I am sure you are a bit confused, because if you have read something about availability and exergy, there is bound to be some difference in nomenclature, some difference in terminology. So I think if you take care of that, you should appreciate in the end that it is nothing but application of first law and second law. And all those jazzy things are only definitions and terminology. And any problem can always be solved by routine application of first and second law. Yes, sir.
Does it mean that if we are not extracting any work, then the system is reaching 450 the temperature?
Yes.
For example, and in this case it is reaching 346.
So 424.
So what,
instead of 450 it is reaching 424.
So whatever the difference between those two energies, that is unavailability for this particular system.
Yes. See, if you don't extract any work, this is the lost work.
Yes.
And lost work you can say is unavailable work. But actually it is not unavailable work, it is work which you could have obtained. So I think lost work or unextracted work is a better term rather than unavailable work. Okay.
Because in Mumbai University syllabus, they are in every exam, they are specifically asking about unavailability.
So almost every time they are asking four definitions: effectiveness of the system, availability, reversibility and unavailability. Sorry, dead state.
I would like to see what those question papers are, and more than that, I would like to meet the paper setter.
Sir, if the time permits, can you explain this unavailability with some TS diagram?
Yes, we will come to that. When it comes to open systems, it will be clear. It will be clear to some extent. So, shall we move on to open systems? Now, let us look at the same standard analysis for open systems. This is the classical exergy analysis. And just for simplicity, we will assume that a steady state exists. And there is one inlet and one exit. And we will do what is known as a standard analysis. Which means end states, inlet and particularly exit. Remember that in an open system, you should emphasize this to the students that the inlet state is dictated by some other system. So whenever we change an inlet system, inlet state is something we just can't change unless somebody else tells us, okay, now work with a different inlet system. Whereas our exit system, exit state, we will provide, this is my exit state and now whatever is the next piece of equipment you design. Okay. And of course, the interface pressure is pre-decided by mutual discussion as between a boiler and a turbine, turbine and a condenser and so on. So our standard analysis, we consider an open system, single inlet I, single exit E, and this is our control volume, steady state. And let us say that we have Q at T and we have from T, this is Q naught from T naught. And of course, there will be some power output W dot S. The so called shaft work, we will take care of flow work by using enthalpies. First law. Q dot minus W dot is M dot into all that. Since it is steady state, the same M dot comes in, the same M dot goes out. Now Q dot is made up of two components, Q dot and Q dot 0. So Q dot plus Q dot 0 minus W dot S is M dot. Now I will write here delta H plus delta Ek plus delta Ep. But henceforth, I am going to not write this. I am not going to neglect it, but I am not writing it just for simplification. Wherever you see delta H, you can add delta Ek, delta Ep if they are not significant. Wherever you see Hi, you can add Vi squared by 2 plus Gzi if you feel like and if needed. That will just save some time, space. Of course, there is no question of saving a paper ending here, but if you are writing down, you will save paper ending. So this we will write as M dot into He minus Hi. Second law. Q dot by T naught, Q dot by T sigma or integral will become Q dot by T plus Q dot naught by T naught. W dot S has nothing to do with second law, plus S dot P is M dot into SE minus SI. Multiply this by T naught and you will get Q dot into T naught by T plus Q dot 0 plus T naught S dot P is M dot T naught Sc minus Si. Now we will eliminate Q dot 0 from this equation and this equation by subtracting this equation from this equation, and you should get Q dot 1 minus T naught by Ts, right? That is what we will get from here. This will get eliminated, W dot S minus T naught S dot P minus W dot S minus T naught S dot P equal to M dot HE minus HI minus M dot T naught SE minus. Now take W dot S on one side and put everything else on the other side, and what you will get is an expression quite similar to the earlier one, not T S. Check that the algebra is all right. Is that right? Okay. Now notice that S dot P can only be positive, best situation 0. So this T naught S dot P is only going to reduce whatever is the remaining expression. So this expression is maximum power that can be obtained. Again, remember standard analysis: by keeping the inlet and exit or the end states fixed, the interaction Q at Q dot at T fixed, the only change allowed is Q naught. You are allowed to vary with T naught, vary at T naught. Okay. So the only modification allowed is exchange of heat with the environment. What is this without the negative sign? We called it lost work there, we will call it lost power. Okay. This is maximum power available because of Q naught at T naught. So you can say this is the max power due to Q naught at T, and this you can say because there is a power exergy of Q dot at T. When generally they talk of exergy, they say exergy of Q dot, and they say it depends on the temperature on at which it is available. But we should be clear, thermodynamics says heat is always associated with the temperature level at which it is available. So when you say Q dot at T, only in first law we talk of Q dot. In the second law, the moment it is second law, every Q dot is associated with a temperature. What is this with the negative sign? Is the maximum power that can be obtained when the stream goes in at I and comes out at E. See, this is the maximum power due to flow m dot from inlet to exit. This is quite often known as the exergetic power. But mind you, you bring 10 books and 10 papers on availability or exergy, you will have 10 different nomenclatures and 10 different terminology. This is maximum power due to flow of m dot from inlet to exit. And notice that not only does it depend on inlet and exit enthalpies, it also depends on inlet and exit entropies, as is expected because second law has been used, and the environment temperature T naught. And of course, this is lost power. Now, nomenclature, this term is quite often written as equal to minus m dot BE minus BI, where B is defined as H minus T naught S and is exergy of flow. So, B also is something like a potential. The decrease in which multiplied by m dot gives you the maximum power obtainable because of that flow through an open system. This is perfectly analogous to what we wrote for the closed systems. Now, the restriction here is we have considered one inlet, one exit. If there are more than one inlet exit, we know how to take care of those terms. Similarly, if it is not a steady state, you will have that d by dt of that phi, that term will also be coming in. You can derive an expression. I derived it like this without taking into account that term, just to reduce the clutter. And of course, I have reduced clutter. Remember, when I say HE here, it is actually HE plus VE squared by 2 plus GZE. Similarly, HI is HI plus VI squared by 2 plus GZE. Put those terms whenever necessary or whenever needed. Now, shall we start looking at exercises, or is there a question? Realize that, go back, if you have written things down, you will find that this expression, I will call this Y, is very similar to this earlier expression. Where was that? X. Look at the similarity and look at the differences. The similarity becomes striking because this gets replaced by that m dot delta B. Here it is because of change of state of the system. There it is because of change of state of the flow from inlet to exit. And this term also exists. Actually, d by dt of this term will exist there. But we have considered a steady state, so there that term doesn't exist. Otherwise, this will also exist there. But even otherwise, look at the similarity between the first term, second term, third term here in the expression X, and the first term, second term, and third term here in the expression Y. And you will, the similarity is more striking if you replace HE by UE or EE plus PEV. Then there also a E term, a PV term, and a TS term. Here also there is a E or U term, a PV term, and a TS term. So, as Mandar Tendulkar says, they have reached nano Kelvin. The question still arises is, are you sure it is nano Kelvin? So there are issues of measurement, not only issues of reaching that, but how do you measure the temperature? That is only deduced. It is, if you look at it, it turns out that it is always better to work at a lower T naught. But T naught, that one conclusion one can always draw is, look, why consider T naught as fixed? Consider as variable or adjustable. Adjustable means not easily variable, but you can consider another situation where it is different. So, But that means, for example, Delhi in summer, most of the engineering systems are designed assuming T naught of the order of 35-40. On some days it will even be 45. Okay. You go to Leh nowadays, Leh in December, minus 20, minus 30 Celsius. So why not do everything on at the North Pole or everything in the Antarctic? Then we will be able to, you know, extract more power out of everything. And then there will be other problems, other issues. So what you are thinking of is, you know, zero Kelvin. But then apparently the interstellar space temperature, you know, the background radiation, that is about 4 Kelvin. So naturally perhaps that is the lowest temperature you can expect to reach. But that means put all our power plants on a huge satellite and let it go far away. And then how do you transmit the power from there to here? How do you make fuel available to that? So we can think about it. And you know, such flights of fancies are useful because that leads to science fiction entertainment. But then again, that now that you have brought it up, that also you know, reminds me of Arthur Clarke's statement that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. So today we may consider it magic if something like that can happen, but maybe another few decades. See, most of the things which have been presented in science fiction novels, whether that of Jules Verne or even Arthur Clarke, who expired only a few years ago, they are coming true. So whatever was science fiction 50 years ago is almost a fact today. So nothing wrong in imagining, but we being engineers, we should realize the current difficulties in achieving that. Maybe our grandkids will achieve it. It won't be that much difficult for me. Okay, so now let's start looking at exercises. Let me look at now 7.2 we have tackled. Okay, let's take 7.4 first. We have an adiabatic turbine expanding air. Inlet 8 bar 1200 Kelvin, exit 1 bar, isentropic efficiency 0.85, air flow rate 2 kg per second. Air turbine. M dot 2 kg per second. Inlet 12 bar, sorry, 8 bar 1200 Kelvin. Exit 1 bar. This is as specified, adiabatic turbine, and of course eta T 0.85. Let us first work our standard problem, power output. That is what first thing is on. So we sketch the TS diagram. Because it is an air, the TS diagram also represents the HS diagram. So you will have an 1 bar line and we will have a 12 bar line, 8 bar line. let us say this is the inlet state I, this is the isentropic exit state E star, actual exit state E, ideal exit state E star. This is 1200 K. How do you proceed? First, we calculate T E star using the isentropic relation. T E star by T I is P E by P I raised to gamma minus 1 by gamma. We will assume air to be an ideal gas, constant Cp, okay. So, here Pe is given, Pi is given, Ti is known, gamma has been assumed. So, that gives us TE star. Okay. Now, the isentropic efficiency eta S is given to be 0.85, which turns out to be W dot S divided by W dot S star. Max, let us not use the word here, which is m dot Cp Ti minus Te divided by m dot Cp Ti minus Te star. This equals this, this equals this. So, the idea is from we have Te star, Ti, m dot and Cp, we get Ws star. From Ws star, we get Ws, W dot S, and from W dot S, we get Te, whichever way. So, this gives us, this expression gives us both Te as well as W dot S, and that solves the problem part A. Now, part B. Maximum power output for the same inlet and exit conditions. Okay. Notice that it is a otherwise adiabatic turbine. So, our Q does not exist, Q at T does not exist. So, W dot S max I E fixed would be by our formula minus m dot BE minus BI or m dot into BI minus BE. Which is equal to m dot into HI minus HE minus T naught S I minus S E. Okay. Out of which M dot H I minus H E is here. Is that right? W dot S. This is equal to W dot S from A. Okay, first part, this part. What is second part? There is a negative sign here, there is a negative sign here. So, I will write plus m dot T naught S E minus S I. I have just flipped it around by taking care of this negative sign. And I also will write this as instead of S I, I will write S E star. Since S E star is S I. Look at this figure. SE star is SI, that is used for definition of isentropic efficiency. So now our W dot, now it is not no new principle, W dot S max I E fixed will be W dot S plus M dot, right, M dot T naught. Now S I minus S E star are at the same pressure level. So there will be Cp ln T E by T E star. Cp ln T E by. Now in this expression you have already W dot S has been computed in A, T naught is given. Assume 300 K unless otherwise stated, M dot is specified, Cp has been assumed, TE has been calculated, TE star has been calculated. Okay. So this gives us the answer to B. Now the question is, how will you obtain this maximum power? This much power you are obtaining already. How do you obtain this power? This is the lost power, isn't it? This is maximum, this is actual, this is the lost power. And if you look at the expression, it is nothing but T naught into S dot P. Because it is an adiabatic turbine, S dot P is nothing but AC minus SI into M dot. So how will you obtain this? Think. You are given ideal, okay, I will give you any amount of ideal pieces of equipment, tell me how will you obtain this. Once you consider that, you will realize the difficulty in obtaining this. Don't talk of vague terms, use ideal pieces of equipment. Ideal pieces of equipment are isentropic turbines, isentropic compressors, heat exchangers with 0 delta Tm, 0 LMTD, you understand what is mean temperature difference of heat exchanger, right? Heat exchangers with 0 LMTD and that means heat transfer with 0 delta T should be possible, and pressure ducts with 0 pressure drop is possible. How will you do this? These are the ideal components available to you. Mind you, you have to maintain the same inlet and exit conditions. Let me draw this figure. TS diagram. We had a 1 bar line and we had an 8 bar line. And we expanded it from 8 bar to 1 bar, but like this. Now we have to keep this I fixed, we have to keep this E fixed, and we must extract this much amount of power. You know how do we go about doing it? Now we are extracting this much power, we must extract this additional power. For that additional power, additional interaction has to take place. Okay, where is that interaction and what type? That has to be a heat interaction with the ambient. So it has to absorb that much energy from the ambient. And how will it absorb? If you look at it, let us say this is the ambient temperature, T naught. Then the requirement is, I will draw it in a different color so that it is clear. Which one? Only one term will come, that is because delta S is Cp ln Te by Te star. Actually, it is minus R ln Pe by Pe star. But this is the same, Pe equals Pe star, so this term drops out. Is that right? Otherwise, I will explain to you during tea time. Let me complete this. Notice that we have to go from here I to E reversibly. So, what I do is I use a reversible isentropic expander right up to the ambient temperature. Then I use an isentropic compressor from ambient temperature to the exit state. But since the exit state is at a different entropy, these two streams have to be joined together by having an isothermal heating process at the ambient temperature. So, I will need three ideal components: an ideal isentropic turbine to bring it up to ambient temperature, then at ambient temperature heat it up so that it reaches the entropy that is needed to go up to E, fixed exit state, and then at that entropy from ambient temperature, whatever is the pressure, compress it up to the required pressure of 1 bar. Just as an illustration, I am assuming that this line happens to be below this, but it could even be above this, does not matter. Just for clarity, I have shown it like this. Now, imagine how difficult it will be to have an isentropic turbine, an isentropic reversible compressor and a 0 delta T heat exchanger at ambient temperature. That too at ambient temperature, mind you. This is the ideal process. And the exergy expert tells us that no, this is what you should do, otherwise you are losing this much power. As engineers, what shall we say? Shall we try doing this or shall we live with losing this power? No, but there is something better we can do. We can say that look, as engineers, turbine engineers, we will look at it in a slightly different way, and that brings us to part C. We have taken care of part B here. What is part C? Part C says, what is the maximum power output if the turbine were to remain adiabatic? Mind you, when you do this to obtain the maximum power, the turbine does not remain adiabatic. It has to exchange heat with the environment. If the turbine were to remain adiabatic, that is problem C, what we will do is, we have 1 bar, we have 8 bar. So, from I, we are going to E. Ideal adiabatic is E star. We will say that for a turbine engineer, turbine designer, a better option would be keep adiabatic. And do not worry about this. This is your going to be your Q naught, making it non-adiabatic. Keep adiabatic, but make it a better and better turbine by reducing irreversibilities within it. Try to bring E to E star. If I were to keep it adiabatic, the best one is adiabatic reversible, which is isentropic. So, the maximum power is if it expands from I to E star, and that answer we have already determined here. That is this WS star, that is the answer for C. And mind you, those of you who are working with turbines, the aim of a turbine designer will always to reach E star rather than to reach this some funny maximum work output. Okay. So, we look at exercise 7.3. We have an adiabatic steam turbine. Inlet 10 bar, 350 degrees C, exit pressure 1 bar, flow rate 5 kg per second. calculate the maximum useful power output from an adiabatic steam turbine. This is A part. Now, what is given to us is the following. We have an adiabatic steam turbine, and for A part diagram, and let us say on the TS diagram, so this is our F line, dry saturated vapor line. This is the 1 bar isobar. It shouldn't go like that. It should go like this. This is 10 bar isobar. This is 350 degrees C isotherm. So this is the state I. In part A, it is asked what is the maximum useful power output from an adiabatic steam turbine if the inlet state is 10 bar 350 degrees C, exit pressure is 1 bar, flow rate 5 kg per second. Now, in the part A, since it is adiabatic, the best is reversible. And adiabatic and reversible means isentropic. Okay. Yesterday when you have gone through that exercise, that the three adjectives adiabatic, reversible and isentropic are vaguely, loosely connected to each other. A process which is adiabatic need not be isentropic, need not be reversible, and anyway, but a process which is adiabatic and reversible must be isentropic. So, any one of the three does not imply any of the remaining two, but any two of the three automatically means the third one, because the relation is like A plus B plus C is 0. If one of them is 0, the other two can have appropriate values, positive, negative, 0. But if two are 0, A and B, then C has to be 0, it has no choice. Okay. The total freedom is gone. So, this means reversible. And hence, in the case A, the process will be like this. This is E for A. So, the W dot S or W dot S max is obtained by using an isentropic process from I to PE, whatever is the inlet state I to the exit pressure PE. Yes, it is max, because we are restraining it to adiabatic. So, under adiabatic condition, the best thing one can do is make it adiabatic reversible, which is isentropic. In this case, entropy produced would be 0. So, this will be the maximum possible power output if you constrain it to be adiabatic. Now, let us look at the second part. In the second part, rework the problem if the steam loses 40 kilojoule per kg of heat to the atmosphere, which is at 300 K. What is the exit state in this case? So, now in case of B, we are told that although we make an effort to keep it insulated, it is not insulated. So, you have an inlet state I which is 10 bar 350 degrees Celsius, you have an exit state which is 1 bar. But the thing is not adiabatic. There is a Q dot which comes from the ambient, which is at 300 K. And Q dot is given as M dot into 40 kilojoule per kg. Is the M dot specified? Flow rate is 5 kg per second. So, 5 into 40, 200 kilowatt is the heat lost, and this is with a negative sign, minus 40. Heat is lost to the ambient. And that means it is no more adiabatic. I can't write Q dot equal to 0. So, how do you proceed? What is the best exit state? Not isentropy. The best exit state is the state which produces no entropy. Okay. So, the ideal exit state in this case is the one which produces. So, with this case, remember our first law, we say let the exit state be E. The first law says Q dot minus W dot S equals M dot into HI minus HE. In this, W dot S is to be determined, M dot is given, HI is known, HE is not known. Okay. What about Q dot? Q dot is given to be minus 40 kilojoule per kilogram into M dot. So, Q dot here turns out to be minus 200 kilowatt. So, we can't determine W dot S unless we determine HE. So, how do you get HE? We have to use second law. What is second law? Q by T, Q dot by T. So, there is a Q dot by T naught plus S dot P equals M dot into SE minus SI. What is S dot P? Should be 0. Because our basic idea is S dot P is the best for us, utopia, heavens. So now here Q dot is known, T naught is known, M dot is known, SI is known. So you determine SE. And now notice, how does AC compare with SI? S dot P is 0, Q dot is negative. So, SE is lower than SI. Got it? So, from here, obtain SE. Exit pressure is known to us. So, PE SE fixes the exit state, which fixes HE, and from which we get W dot S. Okay. This thing will be clear when we sketch the TS diagram. This is I, this is SI, but our SE is less than SI since Q dot by T naught is less than 0. It is losing heat, so Q dot is negative. So, our SE, which is actually the SE star, the ideal one already based on S dot P equal to 0, is below SI, the actual process would be something like this. Is that clear? Now, before we proceed, one last parting shot, that is for an adiabatic turbine, W dot S is less than W dot S star. and this is known as the isentropic efficiency. We are already familiar with this. For any turbine, for that matter any turbine or some similar thing, we can also have this W dot S will always be less than or at most equal to W dot S max as determined by our combined first and second laws. But we know that W dot S max and W dot H star need not be the same, that 7.4 has told us. So this is another ratio, W dot S by W dot S max would be defined, this would be less than or equal to 1. This is quite often defined as, and this is known as the exergetic efficiency. Another term, no new concept, it is an exergetic efficiency. Now which efficiency shall we really look at? As exergy engineers we should always look at this, because this is the maximum you could have obtained, you have obtained only this, so this must be the exergetic efficiency. But a turbine engineer will always look at it. Because a turbine engineer knows that look, I have to have my turbine adiabatic, there is absolutely no point in exchanging heat. So the maximum I can do is isentropic turbine. So a turbine engineer will always look at isentropic efficiency, he will not look at exergetic efficiency, because as an engineer that is what one has to aim for. He will well insulate the turbine, he will not say let there be some heat loss, I will run a heat engine between that and the atmosphere, you will not worry about it. And finally, one should draw a line and show something like this. If this is 0, this is positive and this is negative. On this side we have turbines. Produce power. On this side we have compressors, pumps, etc. which need to be driven, they absorb power. W dot T will be here and W dot T star. I am writing T because I am writing it for a turbine. So this will be less than this or at most equal to. These two depending on the conditions may be higher or lower compared to each other. And hence the ratio of this, this goes in the numerator, this goes in the denominator whenever we define an efficiency. When it comes to a compressor, the relative location is the same thing, but both are negative. W dot C, W dot C star, W dot C the so called max. But it is an algebraic maximum, it is not a numerical maximum, numerically it may be a minimum. The relation is still less than like this, but here both are positive, here both are negative. And hence when it comes to defining efficiencies of any kind, it is W dot T by W dot T star or W dot T divided by W dot T max. Because psychologically we are, whenever we say something is an efficiency, we want it to be a number less than or equal to 1. That is why for refrigerators we say COP, we do not call it efficiency, refrigerators and heat pumps. But since both are negative, in magnitude W dot C will be higher than that of W dot C star or W dot C max. So when it comes to efficiency here, we define it as W dot C star by W dot or by W dot C max by W dot C. Okay. This diagram, I think if you show, then there is no confusion about why one efficiency definition is sort of reciprocal of the other efficiency definition. But the less than remains always less than, but in an algebraic sense. Here it may be 1000 ideal, 800 real, but both are positive. Here it may be 1000 ideal, but minus 1000, the real may be minus 1200. It is lower than minus 1000. Magnitude wise it is higher, hence for efficiency we put it the other way. Yes sir.
Sometimes a term used second law efficiency.
That is exergetic efficiency. Exergetic efficiency also it is sometimes known as second law efficiency.
Excuse me sir, is it possible to get exergetic efficiency as one?
In principle, yes. If you, for example, if you are talking of isentropic efficiency, make the turbine run as isentropic. In that case, you will get isentropic efficiency 1. Or in case of a general process where you may be talking about exergetic efficiency, make the whole process run as a reversible process. In that case, you will get the second law efficiency or the exergetic efficiency to be 1. Notice that both a isentropic reversible process, which means a zero entropy producing process, or a zero entropy production process, any other kind, is a thermodynamically utopian process, ideal. It is used only as a reference. Engineers will achieve, for example, from an isentropic, over the years, the isentropic efficiencies of the turbines must have gone up from 0.7 to 0.8, maybe slightly higher than 0.8. But as you start approaching the ideality, the cost goes up. So if you look at any process and plot it, sorry, this is positive, this is negative. And here you put cost. So a turbine, a very simple turbine, not much of technologically advanced one, will produce lot of entropy, but will not cost much. But the same turbine, if you try to make it jazzier, less entropy producing, more isentropic efficiency, the cost will shoot up as you come to near reversibility. Will shoot up to such high values that the management says that look, it is too costly. People will prefer to have a slightly inefficient turbine at a much less price than an efficient turbine at maybe 10 times the cost. And this zone is impossibility. Whatever you invest, this is impossible. You turbine with negative entropy production is just not possible. Why turbine, nozzle, anything? Someone who does not understand the second law will try to design nozzles which work here, but they do not work. On paper you can do anything, you cannot make it work.
Problem number 7.83.
Right. Which one? No, entropy production is 0. Exit entropy is lower than inlet entropy. So that is there just to indicate that one should not have a mental set that ideal case means exit entropy equal to inlet entropy. That is only in case of adiabatic. If you are losing heat, ideal exit state is likely to be at a lower entropy than the inlet exit state. Is that okay? Now,
sir, for the reversible adiabatic process, isentropic efficiency and the exergetic efficiency matches.
For a reversible adiabatic process, reversible adiabatic process means ideal process. That means S dot P is 0, and that means both the definition, both the efficiencies will be 1 when they will match. I think they will definitely match when they are 1, but I do not know whether they will match in some other cases also. They may, accidentally they may. But naturally, when an efficiency is 0 by any definition, it will be 0. When efficiency is 1, I think by any reasonable definition, efficiency will be 1. But this is where thermodynamics sort of diverges from engineering. You know, actually basic thermodynamics does not comment. It says this is what is possible, this is what is not possible. It is the, when you do exergy analysis, you say that look, this is the best possible and you should try to approach it. That is where engineers are likely to differ. A turbine engineer will look at an ideal turbine in a different way, and exergy engineer will look at an ideal turbine in a different way. And when it comes to a real engineer, the real engineer will always be comfortable with economics. So he will have a figure like this. He will understand that it makes sense to produce lower entropy, but it does cost more money to do it. And in an environment of competition, you have to always see what your competitors are doing and selling. So I think we stop here.